jump in and start. First of all, my name is Mark Silverstein. My boat is
Field Trip, and my boat is located in Malaysia.
We still live on our boat,
but I'm actually in Argentina right now. So we have spent the last couple days doing the commissioning of the first hybrid. So it's been very long days. It's been very good, very productive, but my voice is gone. I've been talking and it's been just flat out down here in Argentina.
So that's me in a nutshell. Let's see, Lisa, can you do your introduction, please?
So I am Lisa Caudill, and our boat is Sailing Vessel Unwritten Timeline. She's a 2003 PDQ Antares, and she's in Merritt, North Carolina. And I am in Argentina with Mark and David at the moment, helping with the hybrid. When I say helping, I'm pretty much watching the waves go by and enjoying the sunshine. But yeah, so here enjoying Argentina for the first time. Loving it.
That's great. Thank you very much, Lisa. Mark, introduction.
Yes, I'm Mark Solari. I'm the proud owner for the last 2 years. In fact, we celebrated what we call our Sereniversary. So the boat's name is Serenity, and it's a 2 year anniversary since we moved aboard yesterday. So 2+ years, and have been cruising basically up and down the Pacific coast.
And you're located right now?
We are located right now in Chamela, Mexico, which is close to Barra de Navidad, south of Puerto Vallarta.
Okay, very good. Thank you so much. And Glenn?
Glenn, I'm Glenn McGonigal. My wife Pam and I are owners of Mira, a 2017 Antares. We've been semi-full-time aboard since 2017, cruising East Coast, Caribbean, Mediterranean, and back. And we've just been up the Pacific coast and returned back to the Panama Canal, and presently going to be cruising Western Caribbean.
All right. So let's go through and let's first jump into the first topic, which is stainless steel and keeping our stainless steel clean. What I wanted to do is just show you three different pictures. And one is a turnbuckle that looks kind of crappy, a little bit rust on it. Then you have a stanchion mount that has rust on the stainless steel, but it also has rust bleeding over to the, in this case, the gel coat. And then finally, the rigging swage. And of these three different types of corrosion, the worst type is on your rigging. And it's really important to not only keep your stainless steel clean so it looks pretty and looks nice, but it's also important for the structural integrity of your rigging. And as soon as you start to get corrosion, like you see here on this swage, you can have failure in your strands of your stainless steel, in this case, on the shroud, and that can be problematic. So the question is, how do we keep this clean and what do we do about it? So let's jump into that. There are three stages that we think about when we're cleaning our stainless steel. The first one is just, how do we get stainless steel, if it looks junky or starting to look corroded, how do we get it clean on the stainless steel? Second, how do we go through and remove the rust on gel coat and get that to look nice? And then finally, how do we keep it looking nice so we don't have to go through three or four times a year, polish our stainless steel? And there are different methods that we've used as owners to do this. And we want to talk about some of those methods and what's worked for us. If we start with the first stage, which is just keeping our stainless steel clean, how do we get that, the corrosion that starts to exist on our stainless steel? There are a number of different products that we've used as owners. And what I would like to do is have us talk about what's worked for us, how and why. So on my boat specifically, I've used two main products, which is the 3M metal polish, which is a paste, and it works very well with a clean rag to go through and get that rust off. But sometimes, in particular, when you're looking at rigging and you're looking at a swage, I use a gel. And in particular, I use Grunt, which is difficult to find, unfortunately, but there's similar products that exist. It's made in New Zealand. It's a very mild acid that will remove over time that rust. You can wipe it clean and then keep it polished. So those are the two main things that I've used on my boat that have worked very well. Glenn, I'd like you to jump in and talk specifically about some of the products that you've used on your boat and how they worked.
Yeah, no, glad to. And I think one thing that's worth pointing out for folks that might be considering taking delivery of a new Antares, I learned this the first time we took delivery of Mira. New stainless tends to exhibit more corrosion until it settles down. And there's a metallurgical reason for that. I can't explain it on this call, but I think some of us newbies were like, what's wrong with the stainless? And it did settle down, and it does take care, and these products are designed to do that. We've had great success for the specific polish of stainless with Mother's Magwheel aluminum polish. This is a funny story, but I went through every off-the-shelf West Marine product, you know, trying to find something that would work and would last. And I had some bright work or stainless work done in Annapolis by a really good guy. And I said, hey, what do you use? What do you recommend for stainless polish? And he said, believe it or not, you know, this is great stuff. It's cheap. You can find it on Amazon and a lot of stores in the US. And I've used it for the last 5 years now, and it's been just fantastic. And, you know, once, maybe twice a year, and you know, our stainless stays great with, you know, rinse off and so forth. On the swages, which I agree with you, Mark, really important to keep that clean and corrosion free. I got in the habit, again, through recommendation of another old salt, just periodically put WD-40, you know, inside there to kind of keep the water from building. And then where corrosion does start to build in both the, you know, swages, turnbuckles, and small little things, you take a toothbrush with this spotless stainless stuff, which is really just a citric acid gel, mild, acidic, and let it sit for about 10, 15 minutes. And then you rinse it heavily, you know, with a really wet rag and a lot of water. And it's amazing what it's done for us. And it's our go-to stuff for rust stains on the gel coat as well.
Okay, very good. Thank you for that. And Mark, I know that you have talked about, let me see here, if I can go to the next screen. You've talked about specifically some of the things that you've used for removing rust stains on gel coat. And I'll let you jump in and kind of share some of your experiences with naval jelly in particular.
Yeah, the in the same way that Glenn uses his product, I've done research and I found that the citric acid may be perhaps more appropriate for swages because you want something more gentle there.
Yeah.
But for where we have gel coat, the Loctite naval jelly with phosphoric acid seems to be a lot more effective in my experience. So that's what we use in the case, for example, of that photo where you show the stanchion with the rust coming through, as well on the stainless steel cleats. Pretty much any stainless steel fitting fitted to the deck with gel coat is going to form rust stains in time with our experience. So naval jellies are going to.
And so a question for you, Mark, I mean, how hard is it to find? I've never heard of it, so I'm glad that you brought this up. I mean, has it been hard for you to find the Loctite naval jelly?
No, I got mine on Amazon. And okay. I guess, you know, there are, as you mentioned, in New Zealand with Grunt, there are regional best in class cleaners. Sure. But I've had the fortune of being often enough in California that I shuttle back and forth.
Yeah, I think we just lost you there just at the last second. So I do want to point out a couple things, very difficult lessons learned for me when it comes to removing rust stains on gel coat. And that's all four of these products and a lot of other products that do the same thing. They all have one main thing in common. They're acidic. It's acid. What you don't know, unless you do some research, and we'll talk about that in the next slide, is just how strong are these relative to each other. And the stronger the acid, the more damage it can do, and it will damage your gel coat. I have accidentally left, in particular, on off on a part of my on my gel coat that it did not wash off like I should have. I thought I did, and I just forget. I find a small spot that's really bad, and it will discolor your gel coat, and it is not reversible. So I have a couple spots on my boat that have turned a little bit gray, and that is because I've left an acid on my gel coat too long. So you must be very careful with that. And I would also caution you on using any of these products with the exception of Grunt, and I'll explain to you why in a minute, on any of your stainless steel. If you do, you need to get it off very quickly because it will etch that stainless steel, and it's very difficult to polish it back out. So acid on stainless steel is generally not a good idea. If it's a mild acid like the acetic acid that Glenn talked about, not as big of a problem. But just to kind of put things in perspective, I thought it would be just fun to spend a minute on this slide and to show you something. I actually have a degree in chemistry, so I like to kind of go through and see what's the pH of this. So I pulled up the spec sheets from the manufacturer. They're required to show the composition of each of these different products and the pH as part of a safety component. And so without going into detail on pH and making this a lesson, what I wanted to show you is this. Grunt, which is something that I do use on my stainless steel in limited, you know, very controlled environments, is the least strong. But if you look at the citric acid that Glenn was using, it's even less strong than Grunt. So the point is, if I put Grunt and if I move down to the rust stain remover or the navel jelly, they have a pH of 1. And you might think, okay, well, a pH of 1.5 to a pH of 1, that's not that much. That's not that big of a difference. But the reality is it's a lot different. It's 5 times stronger. If you kind of go down the waterfall, and then from the rust stain remover down to the on-off, it's again 5 times stronger. So the strongest of these, a pH of 0.5, is on-off. It's very strong. I would recommend not using that unless it's your last resort, kind of the nuclear option for something even on your gel coat. Try to use something a little bit less strong because you can damage, like I did on my boat, gel coat. When I first was new to my boat, and I had it in St. Lucia, I hired somebody to clean my stainless steel. I didn't know the best way to do it. So I hired a guy. He came out with on-off and put this crap on a lot of my stainless steel with a brush. And he did damage to a couple of my stainless steel fittings that to this day are still screwed up. So the lesson learned is I do everything myself now. And it's just better to educate yourself to understand the differences and how strong these products can be. And they're very corrosive if you're not careful. Corrosion free. So once you've got your stainless steel clean, how do you keep it clean? And Lisa, when you have looked at your boat, I mean, what are some of the things that you have done to keep your stainless steel looking bright without having to go through all the polishing once you've done that?
Things that I do is David and I, every time we go anywhere, even if it's just a day trip to get rid of the salt, we'll do the vinegar. And there's those spray bottles that you can get at Home Depot, Lowe's. It's like a gallon or 5 gallon. And some people use it for like insecticides. I'll do a solution of vinegar and water, and I spray down the strata glass and the canvas, the boat, just spray it all down with fresh water. That works really well. And then after I do a polish, I use Colonite. I've tried Prism and Starbrite Rust-Off and Colonite. Colonite is my favorite. That's my go-to for doing steel. The only thing that I would add, and it's been mentioned a little bit, but for anybody, if anybody's newbie, you have to rinse really, really well you don't want to, like you said, don't leave any of that product on there, because some, especially Starbrite rust remover, you will get more rust coming back if you don't get all, if you don't remove all of that. I'll use right now in Merritt, North Carolina, we have a lot of humidity, so condensation in the morning. And just first thing when I'm doing boat checks and cleaning boats is I go through and dry off all the steel and wipe the steel. And that helps keep it last a little bit longer too.
Yeah. Well, thanks for sharing that, Lisa. I mean, the key takeaway is once you've spent all the effort and time to polish the stainless steel, it's a pretty simple exercise to rinse it after you've been sailing. The key is it's the salt that causes the problem. So if you can keep that salt washed off, and vinegar helps dissolve the salt, that's why you use vinegar, you'll be keeping your stainless steel looking new a lot longer. So let's now move inside the boat, and we have lots of wood on the interiors. I mean, in fact, the entire interior is pretty much a cherry laminate and solid cherry, depending on what different pieces of the furniture are. And so it's important to try to keep that looking as nice as possible. And Lisa, I'm going to pick on you again. Sorry, but I'd like you to just kind of jump in and just talk about some of the tricks that you use on keeping the wood clean and looking nice on your boat.
So pretty much what I do is everyday use, I'll just use water, but in the galley, if there's a lot of grease or there just seems like if you feel the wood and you feel anything on it, I'll do the vinegar and water. And then there's two products that I like. Murphy oil soap is my favorite, but if I don't have that, there was one time I found Amish milk, and that works really well also. I only have to do that on our boat. When I first got it, I think it was, I did it twice in a year, but right now I have it down to, because with the oil, the water and the vinegar, I only do it once a year. You don't have to do it that often. And then I do go through and dust quite often, just a dry microfiber. I may be a little tired.
That's okay. Yeah. I know it's late our time. Hey, Glenn, how about you? I know that Glenn, you specifically mentioned Murphy's oil. I've never used it on my boat. What are some of your experiences on the wood?
Yeah, I mean, you can, first of all, our go-to base cleaning for the wood internally is the water vinegar mix that you have listed there. It's great. It's mild, and it does a mild, you know, nice job of cleaning off the build up on the wood. The Murphy's oil soap and maybe like lemon oil, you know, for wood, both I think are great to kind of bring the luster back to the wood. It smells nice. You know, it just, as you know, the wood with all the sun that it gets can start to look a little dry sometimes. And it brings, in my opinion, it brings sort of a nice luster and moisture back to it.
Okay. Very good. Well, we have something else I'm going to show you. I'm going to have Mark talk about it. And this is a general cleaner that Mark introduced me to just recently, in fact, yesterday. So Mark, can you talk about what you do with a 3 parts vinegar and 1 part 409?
Yeah, I mean, we find that lots of residues that end up accumulating also on the wood surfaces. And wood surface, by the way, it's, you know, it's laminated, right? So what you're really doing is to clean not so much the underlying wood as much as the laminate. But we found that, you know, greasy fingerprints, for example, aren't necessarily going to be removed by the vinegar alone or a purely aqueous solution. So we create a 1 part 409 to 3 parts vinegar. And that actually is a product that or a solution that was introduced to us by the former owner of Serenity. And it cuts through, you know, both salt and grease as well. And occasionally we finish with liquid gold, this product here, which is a spray on to give that shiny luster finish back.
Okay. So you use this also to clean countertops and maybe some of the quarrying surfaces as well, not just the wood.
Absolutely. It's our first step go-to cleaner. And then I can talk about another miracle cleaner a little bit later.
Okay, we're going to try that one on Miramar. That sounds pretty cool.
Yeah.
How do you guys clean the stainless backsplash?
We use the same, but I found for the backsplash, if you take some baby oil afterwards with a microfiber cloth, then it creates a kind of a clean sheen. Because the problem with the backsplash is you've got the fingerprints, you've got patterns from the cleaning solution itself, and it's very, very hard to make an even finish. So a tiny bit of mineral oil or baby oil on a microfiber, really thinly applied, gives it the sheen and that luster and that steady finish.
Cool. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Warwick. Hey, Dave, I see your hands up. What's up? What do you have?
So what we found was Barkeep stainless, and the oxidation you see come off when you wipe it down with that is incredible. And then you have to polish it with other stuff. But Barkeep's has been incredible with a lot of the stainless inside the boat.
That's good to know. I use a spray on pretty simple, whatever stainless steel cleaner with a microfiber. That seems to work pretty well, but it still gets messy. So there are different methods on the stainless steel. Well, that was a great question, Glenn, because we didn't cover that in our slides. And that's one of the things that gets messy in the galley for sure. Okay, so we're going to now move from the inside back to the outside and talk about how we keep our topsides and the fiberglass clean on our boats. There are two products that I have used pretty religiously. The one I care most about, and I make sure I always have a stock on board, is this non-skid Starbright deck cleaner. From my experience, it is fantastic. I also strongly recommend, if you don't use the SureHold, I know there are different opinions, and we'll get that in a minute. The SureHold products are expensive, but they're very good. I've had mine for 12 years now. And they've just been fantastic. But the key part for me is keeping the non-skid, getting the dirt off the non-skid, and then keeping the non-skid at least somewhat protected. And why I like the Starbright deck cleaner is because it puts a PTEF coating on there. It is not environmentally friendly, I will say that, because it has PTEF in there, but it does protect the non-skid from my experience, and allow it to not get as oxidized in the sun. We do this weekly. Every week I wash my boat with this product, and my gel coat still looks very good on the non-skid in particular. Mark, any comments that you would have on you and what you use?
Yeah, first we have the we have an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. And I, every morning, because we happen to be in an environment sort of like Lisa, where you have a lot of dew on the decks, to go through with a simple squeegee, sort of like, well, actually, this is the one that I use, you know, brush on one side, squeegee on the other, and just squeegee the decks. You know, I consider it's like morning calisthenics or just a warm-up exercise. It takes no more than 15 minutes. And if you start going from the top down, you'll notice that that particularly the non-skid stays cleaner longer. When there's not much dew on decks, I just take a couple of microfibers and I push them back and forth using the same brushing technique, sort of like mopping, if you will.
And that
helps a lot. Now our boat being slightly older, I was rather annoyed by the fact that every time I would clean the boat, especially brush it with anything as mild as a detergent, for example, I would get clouds of oxidized gel coat in the rinse water, rinsing wherever it goes, usually off the sugar scoop. And so I was looking at solutions. Are there ways to create a coating on the oxidized gel coat itself? And for non-skid, I've actually had success with Polyglow, which is an acrylic sealing product. It's very similar in its formulation to Zepp's Wet Look, which you can get at Home Depot for a quarter of the price of this, which you can, you know, get at Chandlery's. This here costs about $30 for one quart. And on non-skid and only non-skid, I should hasten to add, it creates a brilliant seal. And we find that it's easier to wash. For example, the blood stains from fish on the sugar scoop just go off without needing to be scrubbed at all. And it lasts about half a year, super easy to apply. You need to apply four coats on a dry day. And once applied, it creates seal where we no longer have that oxidation running off. So that's our one too. And by the way, I should say, you need to make sure that the before you apply this or any sealer on be it non-skid or otherwise, that the substrate is as absolutely clean as possible. Because if there are stains, for example, octopus ink or others, red wine, it will lock in those seals as well.
Very good. Well, thanks for sharing. I see Dave, you have got your hand up. Let me have you unmute yourself if you can hear me. Your hand's not up. Okay, it is up, but let's put it down. Not sure how to do that. There we go. Amanda Hill said that they love Woody's boat soap and Woody's wax for the non-skid. So that's their comment. I think the big takeaway is, you know, you've got different products that you can use and on your non-skid. It is trickier on the non-skid because you get a lot of dirt in the grooves, and get some way to get that dirt loosened up and removed is important without being too abrasive on a very, very rough scrubber. So I will just point this out. There are two different main types of brushes you can use: a soft brush, which is the yellow, if you were to use a Sure-Hold, or the white bristle, which is a firm. You might be tempted to use a white bristle because it seems to get some of the dirt out easier, and it does. However, it's also harder on the gel coat. You're really scrubbing, and you'll get more of a cloud of white, to what Mark was talking about. That oxidation will kind of be pulled up. But the big question is, are there any environmentally safe products? Because the previous two I showed you are not necessarily environmentally safe. The answer is there are different alternatives. Generally speaking, if it says it has wax in it, it's not really environmentally friendly. For some reason, this one on the left, this Thetford Marine, was listed by Practical Sailor, I believe, as a very good biodegradable boat wash and wax. Not so sure about that, but I put it on here because it was top rated. What I do want to point out, though, is it might be tempting to get a bunch of Simple Green from Home Depot or wherever, and it does work, but I was doing more research on this just recently for my boat, and there were a number of people that were complaining that they had used Simple Green on acrylic, specifically on acrylic windows, and it caused it to fog. They couldn't get the fog out. They used it even on their clears, which was a major no-no. And you'll even see Simple Green will say, please use and spare, you know, test it first on your surface. But if I have to test it first on my surface, I'm not going to use it on my boat when it comes to washing it, because I don't want to drip somewhere that I haven't tested and cause a problem. So that's the only thing I would say is be careful. It's a green product, but it's maybe not that good for your acrylics. All right, we'll keep moving. And I think we've covered this sort of the frequency of washing, but Glenn, can you just talk about your boat and what you do on your stainless and topsides? Just how frequently do you have to do this stuff to keep it looking clean?
Yeah, probably more often than I do it, but you know, for the last 8-9 months, we've been in a fairly rainy time of year, so the rinse off has been by nature, thankfully. So we haven't had too much worry about salt on topsides or stainless. and the polish has been, gosh, last time we polished was June, I think. And we just left the boat a couple weeks ago and it was looking great. So regular polish for us is kind of a 12, 9 months kind of thing, depending upon where we are. Yeah. I'm taking some notes here as we're talking here, because, you know, we're, for a long time, you know, because the boat was fairly new, you know, well, it looks shiny. And I notice now I'm starting to see a little more oxidation on the top side. So we're going to start paying a little more attention to protecting it as well as cleaning it.
Yeah. You know, I had a guy, Glenn, that polishes boats for a living. And he said, you really should think about polishing with a foam disc that has kind of like cleats, not cleats on it, but like a egg crate, whatever look on the bottom of it, on your non-skid, and put a little bit of this 3M product on there to polish it out. And he said it will not chalk up as much. And he did it on a portion of my non-skid. That was a pain in the butt to do, but he did. And I'll be darned if it didn't look pretty darn new when he did that. So he swears by it. It just takes a long time to do it on your non-skid because it does tend to chew up those foam pads. But I bought a bunch of them and plan to do it on my boat, but I haven't done it yet. But that was one thing he said that would help prevent the oxidation, would be to polish your non-skid. I don't know. It seemed to be pretty decent when he did it on my boat.
Rotating disc.
Yep. Kind of an orbital, I have a DeWalt buffer basically. Yeah. Low speed. And it did make it look very nice. And it does seem to still look nice. So I don't know. Just something to think about.
No, that's great.
Yeah. Somebody just put a couple things on here. One question somebody had, and I'll jump in here, and that's from the Hales. Anyone have any experience with the Ecolox Tech hypochlorous solution? They bought an acid generator and use it all the time in spray bottles for many things, mostly as a sanitizer. We call it baby bleach. All you do is add salt and vinegar to the machine. I've never heard of that. Anybody else ever heard of that? Sarah and Stephen, that is a never heard of it. So we'd love to learn more about it. Maybe we can, you can send some more information on that one. Very interesting.
Yeah, I can weigh in slightly.
Okay, go ahead, Mark.
It creates something called hypochlorous acid, and it is a broad spectrum disinfectant. And if you actually, instead of the vinegar, you add a little bit of baking soda, then it cuts through grease as well. But you need a machine in order to make it. To the best of my knowledge, there are very few outfits that actually sell the finished product, and it uses electrocatalysis to make. So it's not the easiest solution to produce, but it's a fantastic alternative to sodium hypochlorite, which is bleach. The common name, bleach, exactly.
Yeah.
Which is toxic and basically used in very limited quantities on our boat as well.
Yeah.
Talk Mark, about thank you for giving these more science perspective on it. When I mentioned baby bleach, it's because it smells like a YMCA that's had a mild treatment of bleach. Yeah. It works as a sanitizer, and we think it's going to be brilliant on the boat. I just held up the photograph of the unit. We paid more for it, but they're now on sale for about $199. And all you do is add two grams of salt and a vinegar. Pretty much everyone has those in their cupboards. In your RV, your Antares, or your house. And we use a 1 quart or 1 liter spray bottle. We use it on all sorts of stuff, especially the cat litter boxes, but I think on a boat, it's going to be great at remediating mold and keeping ahead of things without the heavy duty risk of bleach.
And it's not that high in acid. So, it's like what did it say, like 2.5 to 3.5?
Three and a half.
Even as a rinse for spraying stuff off.
Yeah, the only caveat I would have is that based on the electrocatalytic mechanism, and you can taste it, by the way. I mean, it's so user friendly. I would sell generators for mainly healthcare purposes, right? And I would take the spray bottle with the solution in it, and I'd say, how many cleaning products do you know that you can do this with? And I'd spray it in my eye, and shock and horror, you know, people would be like, oh my God, you just blinded yourself. It's that user friendly. However, on boats, it leaves a slight residue of salt, and salt attracts moisture, and mildew loves moisture. So yes, it will absolutely kill the mildew, but that salt residue, unless rinsed off subsequently with water, for example, or vinegar, may actually be attracting the very thing you want to avoid. Just a little word of caution.
We'll let you know in 2 years how it works.
Yeah, but as a general disinfectant, oh my God, it's so user-friendly. It's fantastic.
That's great. Well, thanks guys for sharing. I learned something new. I had no idea. I never heard of it. All right, we'll move on and we'll talk about something that is near and dear to my heart, which is trying to keep the gel coat once it's clean. If you get spider cracks, which is going to happen anytime a boat flexes, you will get them in certain areas. And I do have them on my boat. And I try to figure out how in the heck, what's a good way to get rid of them. And so what I found that works well on my boat is, first of all, a dental tool. So I use this small dental tool to actually scrape out the junk that can kind of collect in these small hairline cracks. And then I've used both of these two products on my boat. Hairline Fix I actually got in New Zealand, but you can get it in other places as well. And of course, just the general gel coat repair kit. The question might come up, well, how do you match the gel coat? The good news is you don't really need to match the gel coat if you just use pure white or pretty close to pure white, because it's such a small hairline, you can actually put in the gel coat and then wipe it off, and it will fill that little crevice with a gel coat, and it actually looks pretty good. So you can see here before and after, you can still see a little bit of the hairline cracks, but it does overall a very good job to at least be able to get rid of some of those gel coats that do come up. I will ask, Glenn, have you had to do any of this on your boat or tried yet? I'm just curious. We didn't talk about this before, but any?
Yeah. And to be honest, mostly I've saved the work, until I could, justify having somebody in a yard do it for me, Mark.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I'm curious about this as well. I was particularly sensitive when I had, labor do it for me to matching the color.
Yeah.
And we had one incident where we got a little abrasion on the side of one of the hulls on the dock in the Azores. And, so it was a bigger area. And so matching the color was really important. And the guy did a great job. I mean, you can't see it at all anymore, but I was interested to hear your comment about, you know, and the hairline cracks, just going with a pure white. I had a few repairs done and I watched the guy do it on the hairlines, and he took a little, you know, very mild sandpaper to the area first before applying the gel coat. But there it was more of a smear than just in the cracks.
Yeah. Interesting. I haven't tried that yet, so that's something I'll try. Dave, I see your hands up. So Mr. Ebert, go ahead.
So as I learn boats, I'm learning all about gel coat repair, and I've researched it to the nth degree because I like to be able to do everything myself. I have gone through trouble of routing out the cracks to make sure they don't reappear by just wiping it over top. So I am usually sanding. And I basically found it's just like working with sheetrock. It really does sand down fast. It's very forgiving. The trick was finding the color match, because white is not white. I did find a place in Texas called ResTech that will color match. If you send them a piece of your boat, they'll color match. only to find out that they couldn't color match my white because their whitest white wasn't as white as what I have. Later at the boat show, somebody came on one of the boats I was on and he had some gel coat manufacturer I recommended and I started grilling him. Apparently there's different pigments depending on what country you're in. So he was saying, if you can't match a white, that means it's probably built someplace internationally. I'm like, well, yeah, it was built in Argentina. He goes, so just, I guess, a word to the wise, anybody trying to do real gel coat repair, there is a place that can do it. I liked it because you get quart size. You don't need a whole gallon to do these type of patches because it only lasts maybe a year or so. So it's very inexpensive, but when you're having trouble matching a white, maybe try to find something international.
Yeah. So hey Dave, what I'll jump in on, and something that I asked for when I purchased my boat and I did not get, and I kicked myself, and it may not have mattered because it probably won't last that long. I don't know. But if you do have the opportunity, and I'll bring this up to Jerome on his boat down here, it wouldn't be a bad idea to just have the boatyard give you a little pint of that same gel coat that they used for your boat, because gel coats will vary from boat to boat, even from the same supplier. You'll get a little bit different shades of white. It just happens. And so it might be a good idea to have some on board just to have it if you're buying a boat new, something to at least think about. I just thought about that because I did ask for that when I bought my boat 12 years ago and I never got it and I wish I did. But anyway, it is what it is. All right, we'll keep moving on.
So even if you get it, it will last maybe a year or two.
Oh, that's and all. Okay.
So yeah, it does. I don't know what happens, but they said that you got to use it up. And the other thing is the sun then changes the color because it bleaches out. So
yeah,
you're never going to win, but
never going
to
win.
Fun to trying to do it.
Yeah. Well, I'm going to jump into something that is nasty on a boat, but it happens, and it's mold and mildew. And Lisa, I'm going to have you please jump in and talk about some of the stuff that you do for mold control.
Yeah, so if you have not met me, my nickname is the Mistress of Mold. I am battling mold and mildew all the time. My favorite is Concrobium, and for some people, you know, there is that home formula, the formula A and B, I think you had, Practical Sailor. So I actually did a test with the home formula. I bought all of those, the TSP, the baking soda, borax, did the concoction, compared it with a Concrobium, and Concrobium, even though it's similar, it must be the actual, maybe the temperature of the hot water, something's different because it did work better than my home concoctions that I made several different times. But some of the things to do, like if you're leaving your boat any amount of time, is of course damp rid, any kind of airflow, whether it's AC unit, dehumidifier, fans, you want to kind of do those things. I like the hanging damp rid in the closets. Those seem to work really, really well, especially on the Antares. You want it on your port aft cabin because that's where mold and mildew it seems to grow there quicker than anywhere else on the boat. I'll usually do the headliner and things like that with vinegar and water, but if I have a lot of mold or mildew, I'll use the Concrobium. And I don't know if everybody knows this because you have the spray bottles, but Concrobium also has foggers. And then when I was talking about with the vinegar water thing, I bought a separate one just for Concrobium. It's about 1 gallon and you put the Concrobium in the sprayer, because now that I clean boats for a living, I got a hold of a couple transom lockers that I was like, wah! And I used that spray bottle. Game changer, total game changer for sure. So give anybody and everybody a tip, because I've heard a lot of people say they use bleach or bleach water, sodium hypochlorite. The thing to know about that, yes, it will kill mold if you hit the mold spores directly. However, what happens is the chlorine and the bleach will evaporate, leaving water, which Mark was, he had mentioned earlier, mold and mildew like water. They like that moisture. So the bleach will then, the bleach feeds the internal mold spores. So the mold spores are actually feeding off of the bleach that you were trying to kill it with. So you just have to be careful with that if you're using a bleach to do the mold and mildew.
Well, that's good to know, Lisa. I pulled the bleach off. I had been using that on my boat and it's driving me nuts in my battery locker. I get some mold in there because it gets moisture dripping down. And I just learned something new. So thank you.
Yeah.
So, you're welcome. So Glenn, I want to pick on you because you just left your boat for a month. What did you do, if anything?
Yeah, so I mean, we've been back and forth to the boat a bunch, and largely we leave the boat in the water in a secure marina with all the seacocks closed except for the Salon AC unit, which we turn into dehumidifier mode, and we run that while we're gone, and that has worked really well in keeping moisture down. And we do put damperid buckets, in hard to reach places like the genset locker, the two aft lockers. Where else? Somewhere else. And that's worked out really well. The combination of that and having a vinegar water wipe down before we leave the boat, just keeping it clean. And we've been really fortunate with that. I wanted to ask to Lisa's comment about Concrobium because we're big believers in it too, but we find it hard to find outside the US. Have you found it where you are, Mark, or anybody else that's sailing outside the US area?
You know what? To be frank, I'd never even heard of it until you guys told me about it when we were trying to prepare this presentation. So I want to look for it, but I'd never even heard of it. So I'm ready to use it.
Yeah, that's that formula B that you have on the slide from Practical Sailor. That's basically a DIY form of Concrobium. Now, unlike Lisa, I have no basis of comparison between that specific formula B and Concrobium. All I know is that the ingredients are pretty much the same, and maybe Concrobium has some, hidden patented ingredients that makes it that much better. But for those outside the States, and what we do is to go with the Formula B there.
Formula B, okay, great. Well, thank you very much, Lisa, for that detailed overview. We now talk about dealing with the vinyl that we have in cockpits. We have vinyl, chairs at the helm, we've got the clears on the boat, and we need to find ways to kind of keep that stuff clean as well. And there are different things to use. And Mark, I'm going to jump on you since you mentioned Marine Spray 9 and talk about that, if you don't mind.
Yeah, two things for the vinyl that work. One is the magic eraser, which again, I don't know how easy it is to find outside of the States. But Spray 9 for not just vinyl, but for any semi-porous surface, including gel coat, seems to work particularly well for everything from the exhaust cloud stain that we have above our exhausts after a long passage. I don't know if everyone gets that, or we're unique, right?
Yeah.
And here at the cockpit, what material this white cockpit table is, but it's particularly sensitive to stains from spills and red wine. Oh my God, that's they say never have red wine on a boat. And after Spray 9, Catherine and I break it out, and we don't care anymore because that Spray 9 is going to cut through wine on gel coat, wine on any surface. So we love it. I have no idea whether or not it's suitable for clears though. So I'm not gonna touch clears, but just specifically for the vinyl, it works great.
Thanks, Mark. Appreciate that. I'll jump in just real quick because I do have Strataglass on my boat and I do use this IMAR 301 on it. It's pretty picky depending on what type of clears you have on your boat, what you can put on it. Some stuff can cause them to fog. Some stuff is very picky. If you just generally use something mild like Joy, Glenn mentioned using Joy or something similar, just a dish soap, which is what I use as well to clean, seems to be fine, but you do need to be a little pickier on some of the clears that you have to be careful how you clean them. That's just a big heads up on that. We'll keep moving along since the time's running down a bit. We have some miscellaneous cleaners here. The one thing I want to point out that acetone is a strong, it's like the nuclear option, if you will, on cleaning stuff. But when it comes to trying to clean the white rubber rub rails that are on my boat, I've tried many different things and acetone cleans it like a champ. We actually use this to clean Halo in Annapolis. They had really a ton of mold on the rubber. You see it kind of in the photo. So I put the photo up here, this rubber piece, and it makes it, it cleans it super fast. There's a 3M product that I used that did a very good job, but when I dove into it, it was basically acetone. So anyway, it is strong, but I've had no problems on my boat cleaning the rubber rail with acetone. Do you want to jump in, Glenn, on your boat? You mentioned Goo Gone and other stuff.
You've pretty much got it there, Mark. That's acetone is very strong. It's a degausser. It's mildly abrasive as well. So you have to be careful with that. We've also used it very carefully. You know how on the cockpit and transom lockers, over time the gaskets can leave dark stains on the surface of the gel coat inside the locker. And I tried a lot of different things to get that off. And ultimately, just mild acetone treatment took it right off.
Yeah. Good. Well, thank you. I know we're getting low, so we'll keep clicking through this. And actually, we're down to Q&A. So we've got 5 more minutes left based on our 1 hour time slot. So let's go through any sort of questions. And I see a question from Tony. Tony, you said there's a product I've used on clear plastic windows called Plexus. Not sure it would benefit to clear on the boat. And I've never heard of Plexus. Do you want to chat about that, Tony, or just leave it at that? Well, it can unmute you real quick. Hold on. There you go. Go ahead, Tony.
It was originally designed for Lexan windshields on race cars and then was used on aircraft. And I used to use it on old, like, MG rear windows, Jaguar convertible rear windows. It comes in a spray container. It's not a super good cleaner, but what it does, in my opinion, is it fills the microscopic pores. It's kind of like a Rain-X for plastic, where your visibility is infinitely better because it fills the microscopic pores. And then the water runs off of it very easily, where you could just then wipe it with a microfiber towel. And maybe you do it 3 or 4 times a year, but how the clear on old race cars compares to the clear on a boat, I'm not 100% sure.
Yeah. Well, interesting. So I'll have to look into that. I've not heard of it. So it'll be something to definitely look into. A couple hands have gone up. So we'll start. I saw Barbara, you first. I'm going to have you unmute and let you jump in. And then we'll go to you next, Stephen and Sarah.
Thanks. No, this has been very informative. I have a quick question. In the beginning, I don't remember who it was talking about like the new boats, how the stainless steel corrodes a little bit more. Is there something you can do to prevent that? Maybe put some of the polish on earlier than, right when you get the boat, or you just have to let it do its thing and then get into the groove of the normal cleaning cycle?
You know, Barbara, I am not certain on that, but one thing that you could try as a test possibly and let everybody else know how it works is, I know Lisa mentioned collinite. metal wax, which is something that I do use on my boat as well. I love it, and it's hard for me to find where I'm located, so I don't have that much more of it. But it does supposedly it's called a metal wax on the stainless steel, so that might help clean it. I'm not sure. I don't know. Glenn, do you have any experience? You mentioned it on your topic.
I did, Mark. And we were told early on it wasn't the factory, but from other experienced boaters that new stainless, the steel leaches through the chromium in the early days. And Mark, you sound like you might be more of the chemist on this, but what we found out is that it was surprisingly rusty at first, and then after the first couple polishes, it settled down and behaved normally.
Okay. Yeah, so Barbara, that's probably the best we have. We don't know. But we'd like you to try it and then report back so we do know.
It'll be a while. Well, let's get Sancho to get our boats done in the right time frame, and I can get that stuff to you.
Sorry, I accidentally muted you there, Stephen and Sarah. Can you, I meant to hit unmute, but I hit mute. There you go. Go ahead.
All good. Based on Tony, thanks for that suggestion of the Plexus. It sounds really interesting. I was absolutely blown away the first time I used Rain-X a couple decades ago at this point, and I didn't believe my friend when he said, if you apply it properly and drive down the highway, the faster you go, the more clearly you can see out your window. Don't use the windshield wipers. Rain-X is pretty amazing stuff. Can you use that on the main windshield? And if not, should we just use the Plexus? Rain-X is pretty widely available.
Yeah, the answer is yes, you can use it on the main windshield because it's all a tempered glass. So it's like a windshield on a car. So you definitely can use Rain-X on the on specifically in the cockpit on the glass. Not, I don't know about putting it on your composite windows that are in the salon. So I don't know about that. You don't need it there anyway.
No, we'll ask when we get down there. That's all covered with black sunshade anyway. So
that's right. That's right.
Windshield, and definitely by the windshield wiper. So Rain-X it is. Thank you.
Yeah. I did see a comment here that Lisa said. I'm just going to read it out loud. And that she said spray 9 is not to be used on glass, plexiglass, or stratoglass. So she just wanted to point that out from her experience. Anybody? Oh, a comment here from Doug, or a question from Doug. Doug asked, we have good success with Novus 1, 2, 3 polishes and cleaners for clears. Doug, do you want to just talk about that? I've never heard of that. Do you want to just mention that if you want to unmute yourself? I don't see, I know you're there somewhere.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, there's a set of products. It's three products labeled 1, 2, 3, and I don't remember the order, but basically there's a heavy polish if you've got deep scratching, and then there's a medium polish if you just have light scratching, and then there's kind of a cleaner final polish for just maintenance. And we've used them on our past boat and this boat with pretty good success.
Okay. Yeah, I've not heard of it, but that's good to know. Anybody else have any more questions or comments? Please do it now, or we will open it up for just general chit chat. We'll call it a wrap on the call. All right. Well, listen, thank
you. Hey guys.
Go ahead.
One of the things that didn't come up was Neverdell wadding way back in the cleaning up the stainless steel. As Mark and some of the other people, you know, saw our boat, it sat for almost three years in a yard, and everything was rusted that could be rusted. And our best item was actually a product called Neverdell. I used it when we for chrome on my motorcycle. And when we all used to have chrome bumpers, and it was amazing, and it's still made. You can't find it usually in California, but you can find it in the rest of the states. And what's cool about it, it's actually a little it's like a can with a bunch of wadding in it, and you pull out what you need, and like you can get a little piece, and you can go. I like when we're on passage, I just kind of go around the cockpit and clean the screws, and you know, you can. It's small enough you can do a screw head, or you can do the whole backsplash, and it's cleaner and polished at the same time.
Okay, well, thanks, Charles, for letting us know. Mark, I have not heard of that either. Somebody else, Mark, jump? Yeah,
Mark. So Elizabeth, I don't know how to raise my hand on this phone, but anyway, that 123 product is called, it's by no, it's called Novus, N-O-V-U-S.
Yep.
It's really good stuff on the composite windows on the saloon.
Okay.
And one time we were spraying for spiders, and it turned out the stuff kind of etched the windows a little bit. It dripped down and it left streaks that we couldn't get washed off of those composite windows.
Yeah.
And I used this 123 stuff, and they're perfect now. I took them off. It polishes out the fine scratches and
really
new. Really? So US 123 is the levels of, you know, three grades. And I did that, like, I think I used the number two initially and then the number one to polish it after that. I don't think I did the heavy dutiest. And it really worked great for restoring the
windows. We used it as well on Mira for the hatch covers, scratches to the hatches.
Oh yeah.
Okay. It worked?
Yes, very well.
Ah, man. Well, I've learned a lot myself. So yeah. That's a good one. I'll have to get that. I probably can't find it very easily in Malaysia, but or not down here in Argentina, but we'll see. I'll definitely need that on my boat. So that's for sure. Novus 123.
Yes. Mark, you can try the Colonite metal polish on your hatch covers as well.
Okay.
It works a charm on those too.
I do have that. So okay, I can give that a go.
So, yeah.
All right. Very good. Anybody else? Anything else? If not, I just want to first say thank you very much to Lisa, to Mark, and to Glenn for participating. We will have another roundtable. We're going to do it. I was going to do it in 2 weeks, but it's just too close to the holidays. So we're going to do it in January. I will send out an invite. We have another topic for that and look forward to doing that. So if you guys want to chit chat or whatever, feel free. I'll keep this open. We have a lot of people online that probably haven't seen each other in a while or new people. So my voice is completely gone. So I've been fighting a cold. So I'll stop talking. If you guys want to jump in and say hi to each other, feel free.